God morning, family. How are we doing today? What a beautiful day it is. What a beautiful opportunity we have in front of us. I am just excited about the warmth outside because I know it makes so many of you smile. Okay, it makes me smile a little bit too. So what a wonderful, beautiful day. We got a couple days of this, and you know, we're on the downhill swing of this thing anyway, right? We know spring's around the corner. This is South Dakota. This is what we do, right? So this is nothing unusual for us to have these cold spells. But as we continue through this series, this bucket list series, there's cold spells that we have in our lives as well. And so it kind of, I'm glad that we're warming up with this final message in this bucket list series, and hopefully it'll thaw our lives out as well. Hopefully it's been good for you and healthy for you. So if you would, please join me as we go before our Father. Dear Lord, thank you so much for today and this moment. Thank you for this message, dear Lord. Lord, as we wrap up this bucket list series and we talk about some bucket list busters, Lord, we ask that you would help us to continue to grasp what it is you're putting before us, that we would grow within this and that we would receive what you have for us and that we would nourish it, dear Lord. That we wouldn't just take it and discard it or just set it aside. Instead, we would actually embrace it. And so, Lord, as we continue through this message, we ask that we want to thank you for helping us with our production issues this morning. And technology is just a terrible thing, Lord. And I thank you for tormenting me with it, I guess. But Lord, please help us go forward with this day, no matter what our torment has been this morning. No matter what our torment has been in the last week or whatever, Lord, we just ask that this message today would help us through that torment, that it would help us to embrace you. And Lord, we just thank you in advance for what you're going to do. And we just pray these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. So has this series been good for everyone? Has this been a series that's made you think and maybe do a as Alexa would say, recalculating, right? Has it helped you to change maybe some of your thought processes and maybe some of your priorities? I hope so, because that's what my prayer has been through this whole series is, let's get better. Let's refocus. Let's get tuned into the things we need to be tuned into. And it's had a common theme throughout, and a common theme being we all die, right? And I think by this point we've figured this out, have we not? That we all die. From the moment where conception begins, from the moment we are conceived, from that moment on, we're headed towards death. Which is, I know it's morbid, but it's a reality, and we have to face our realities. If we're going to live a life, fully alive for God, we have to live the reality of what life is. And it's unexpected, and it's limited on this side of heaven. So it reminds me of a funeral home director used to sign his letters, eventually yours. He knew what was going on, right? He understood life is fragile and it's short-lived and it's unexpected. Death is one of man's greatest fears. And in this world that we're in today, we have fears galore, don't we? I mean, we have fears. There's a fear of wide open spaces called agoraphobia. There's a fear of really tight spaces called claustrophobia. And there's a fear of being afraid of both of those things, because then you can never have a happy home, right? Because it's never going to be home sweet home, because your home's going to be too big or it's going to be too small, right? So there's that fear. There's a fear of the dark. There's a fear of falling. There's a fear of sharks. There's a fear of lobsters. There's a fear of falling down in the dark, landing on a lobster that thinks it's a shark, for crying out loud, right? So there's fears for everything. And it's just crazy that we have so many fears in this world and in our lives. We tend to do some pretty goofy stuff through our fears, don't we? I mean, we look back at it and we go, I don't know why I was afraid. I don't know why it was a problem. That was kind of dumb for me to act that way, right? And so we know it, and there's people who are afraid of the dark, and I've been like, why are you afraid of the dark? What's the problem? I don't know. I just am, and I know it's dumb, right? And so it is what it is, right? We have our fears, And we need to try to release those fears. But nonetheless, we have them right now. And then there's my favorite fear of all is oh my phobia. That's the one where you go, oh my phobia, I don't know why I was afraid of that. Oh, I don't know why I was afraid of that. That's oh my phobia. You can write that one down. That's a Sheldon one. So, all right. So there's that. It's kind of like the woman who went to Mexico on vacation, and when she come home, she's unpacking, and all of a sudden she calls the cops, and she's like, oh, I got a rattlesnake in my overnight bag, and I need you to come get rid of it, right? And so the cops come rushing on over, and by the time they get there, even though they've rushed, by the time they get there, she's throwing the bag out in the middle of the front yard, right? And so they're out there in the front yard gonna take out this very, very dangerous snake out of their bag just to find it's her curling iron cord. It was never a snake at all. But she was so deathly afraid of snakes and so deathly afraid of what could be in the dark depths of that bag that she thought it was a snake. That's kind of what fears do to us, isn't it? So we're gonna keep moving with this. We're gonna wrap this series up this morning with a bucket list busters, okay? And so I want to share with you five bucket list busters, and the first one is family and friends. Family and friends are bucket list busters. Have you ever had, I'm going to go do this, and your family, your friends, your dad's like, are you an idiot? You shouldn't be doing that. Well, you're a dreamer. What are you thinking? Well, why would you do that? There's no way you can afford to do that. Right? We've heard those words, or we've heard someone say those words to their family or their friend. I'm just helping them out. I don't want them to invest all this when I know they can't do it. Right? And so we have family and friends are a huge bucket list buster. Now, they can be a huge support. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying all of them are busting up our bucket lists, but I'm just saying that they can be a huge breaker of bucket lists, though. And oftentimes, most of the time, I contend they're trying to help. They're thinking they're saving you future pain. They're thinking they're saving you future heartbreak. But the reality is that it just busts our bucket lists. It kind of brings to light the old with friends like that who needs enemies kind of thing, right? I want you to remember something, okay? When we do things to stay in the good graces of our loved ones, we sacrifice the greater places purposed by the Holy One. When we do things to stay in the good graces of mom and dad, brother, sister, best bud, we're doing things because I just don't want them to feel bad about it. I don't want them to be upset about it. We're trying to stay in their good graces. Oftentimes, we're telling God no. Okay? He's got a purpose for what he's calling us to do. And we have to have our faith in him. But our family and friends have a tendency to say, well, no, don't do that. I'm helping you. I'm protecting you, right? So fear of family and friends is our first bucket list buster. The second one is not fitting in. Anyone ever not fit in before? No one wants to not fit in, do we? No one wants to be the outcast, the loner. No one wants to be the one that is rejected, right? I could tell you the number one reason we've had since we've started out here, just out here, I can promise you we've had over, and I got to double check my numbers, but I know we've had over 50 brand new guests. And out of those 50 brand new guests, there's a dozen that come consistently or even remotely consistently. I can tell you if a person walks in that door and they do not feel welcomed, they don't feel like they fit in, and that's the thing they think is, will I fit in? Is there anyone there who's going to be like me? And if you'll notice, when we have guests come in, I make every effort, before or after or both, to make sure I'm connecting with our new guests. Why? Because I want them to understand, yes, you fit in. Yeah, there's other people here just like you. I never, and also if you ask our advisory board and our leadership team, they'll tell you, I'm always saying, we got to make sure the guests are welcome. We have to make sure that person who's coming through the door feels welcome, that they are not an outcast within us and among us, right? It's the number one fear for people going to any church. Laurel mentioned something about, you know, with the Living Last Supper, and it is a marvelous opportunity. And that's just it, is we have people come to that who won't go to church because they don't feel comfortable, they don't feel accepted, they feel rejected at church. Okay? So fear of not fitting in. The number three would be fear of failure. Nobody wants to be branded as a loser, do you? What'd you do? Oh, I failed. You know, I mean, you know, they used to say they always go around like that, right? And people kind of felt like they did, right? There's not a single one of us that's a loser. Not if God's our God. There's not a single one of us that's a loser. He didn't make losers. The problem is people feel like they've failed. I could tell you, I do it every time I get near technology that doesn't work, you know? I hate technology. I'm pretty sure the devil invented it just to mess with me, right? I'm just saying. But I can't, if it's messed up, don't bring it to me. I might be able to dial a phone, which some of y'all don't even know what that means anymore. But I know technology is not my friend, right? Okay, so it's not that you're a failure at it. It's that it's not your thing and God didn't gift you at it. Okay? But people are afraid of failing. And it will stop them from achieving the things that God has on their bucket list to do. And it'll stop you from achieving those things that are just a personal bucket list as well. Just a just for me kind of thing. Teddy Roosevelt said, I would rather have a life checkered by failures than never have tried at all. I think that guy is a pretty good guy to listen to. Sorry. I don't know why my throat went dry, sorry. But so it's kind of like Edison. They're like, well, Don't you feel terrible or whatever because you had all these failed light bulb tries? And he's like, no, I might have had 1,000 failures, but I had one that worked. It wasn't that they were failures, they were just ones that didn't work. His failed attempts, as we call them, were never failures to him. They were learning experiences. They were opportunities to grow. But not everyone gets that, right? So fear of failure, that's another bucket list buster. Number four is one that I would contend that most of us have dealt with. Fear of finances. Fear of finances. There's a ton of people out there who struggle with finances over and over and over again. And it doesn't matter how many times Love Inc. does Faith in Finances. It doesn't matter how many times you go to a Dave Ramsey Peace University. It doesn't matter how many great teachers you had in life. There are people who struggle with finances or are afraid of them all the time. I've talked to people who've done Dave Ramsey and not necessarily the Faith and Finances that Love Inc. does, but other ones outside of the Dave Ramsey, and they're still like, I just can't get it, right? And so, and my wife, you ask her, she'll tell you she handles the checkbook, right? Because, you know, every now and then I might need put in check because I'm like, let's just do it, right? But I know that, so I don't even try taking the checkbook. So finances, though. So how many people have you heard that have said, I can't afford to go back to school? Well, I have kids now, so I can't afford to go to college. I have kids, and my spouse just left. I can't afford to go to college. We just bought a house. I can't afford. We got a car. The car just broke down. So I can't afford to go to college like I planned this semester. I can't afford, right? And in so many other areas of life, but education's one that's a huge one that people are like, they say they want to get educated, they want to further their education, but they're like, I just can't. And it brings us back to the reminder of don't dwell on the things that you can't. Don't dwell on the things you can't. Instead, focus on the things you can. Focus on what we can. And as we said earlier in this series, stop begrudging the things, what you can't, and start believing in what you can. Right? Jesus told us, he said, give and it will be given to you. Give and it will be given to you. So many people think that, well, all I got to do is pray and I'll have everything I need. Jesus said, give and it will be given to you. Don't be a tightwad with your heart. Don't hold back the things God's asking you to do. When he's asking you to take a step, take that step. He said, give and it will be given to you. He's not saying, we have this mindset that, well, I should just get everything because I prayed for it. That's not the case. That's not what God says. That's not what our Bible says. God says to give. You see, really what God says is, I've already given you way more than you deserve. How about you start rescinding a little bit of that? How about you start being obedient with what I've already given you? How about you start answering the call I've put before you and doing the things I've asked you to do? And if people would do that, they would see they're being refilled over and over again. The more we give, the more you get. And I learned that so much on mission trips, right? Because I have 4 mission trips now, and all 4 of them mission trips, I came back going, man, I tried giving everything I had. I gave everything I had, and they still outgave me. And they still, I know I received more than what I gave. But you have to continue to give and give and give and let God grow it. So people are afraid of finances. And the fifth one is, fear of faith. Fear of faith. We have this thing about, what if I step out and I'm not doing what God really wanted me to do? It wasn't what God wanted me to do. What if you said, all I got to do is take that step, but what if I step out and I step out going the wrong direction? Did you step out going with the heart that God had given you? Did you step out following your heart? That you believed was from God, that you believed it was him telling you to take that step, he's not going to begrudge you if you did. Now, if you're doing it just because that's what you wanted, whole other ball game, right? But if you're stepping out and doing what God's asking you to do, you don't have to be afraid of it. Have faith in it. Trust it. If we don't step out in faith, I can tell you this. If I don't step out in faith, and this will wrap a whole bunch of these fears kind of together, because I can tell you, I have family members that when I stood up that day in church and said, well, Lord, I heard you this time. We're stepping forward, going to do more for your church. And ultimately became a pastor. If I'd have listened to those who had my ear, never would have happened. Never would have happened. I had plenty of naysayers in my life. Plenty of people who thought I was nuts. Why would I think I should be a pastor? Why would I think I should be working for God? Why would I not? God asked me to. He made it perfectly clear. I knew exactly what I needed to do. When I was asked to stay here and pastor this church when Pastor Brian left, there were some who said, you don't want to do that. You shouldn't do that. And I said, well, God's not telling me that. And I stayed through the faith. And here we are, 2 years later, 2+ years later. I know it was the move I was supposed to make. I didn't listen to my family and friends. If I didn't follow through with the faith that I have in God, if I didn't follow through with the step that he put in front of us, we wouldn't be in this building. There was plenty of naysayers saying, oh, we're just not ready for that. We can't do that. And there's people even now that are kind of like, oh, it's like, no. We're doing what God called us to do. We're taking the step. That's what we have to do in life. If we don't take that step, we will never fulfill the bucket list God has given us. We will never fulfill it. if we continue to be afraid, if we continue to listen to our family and friends, if we continue to lack faith, if we continue to worry about finances, God's the creator of all treasures, folks. All treasures. Does God care if you have an $800 cell phone? Probably not his priority for you, is it? And please don't get me wrong, okay? But when I talk to people and they're struggling, yet we have a house that's three times the size of what we need. We got three more bedrooms and we have people in the house. We got two extra baths compared to the number of people in the house. We have brand new cars sitting in our driveway. We have all the toys and trinkets to go along with it. We have the $800 cell phones for everybody. We got the maximum unlimited data plans and all that kind of stuff. When we have that and you're complaining to me about finances, you're not using God's treasures that he's given you the way he intended you to use them. But when we have faith in God and we trust what he's telling us, and the funny thing is when I have conversations with those folks, you know what oftentimes, almost every time what they'll say is, well, I know I probably shouldn't have this and I probably shouldn't have spent money on that and I probably shouldn't have. They know it. But everyone's just been like, but you deserve it. And we have that instant gratification world that we live in. And we don't be faithful to God. So it's not just taking that step in faith, but it's also being faithful to what God's telling you to do, where he's leading you to go. We have to do what he's asking us to do. And when we do, we will accomplish the bucket list. We will finish the list, his list for us. Fear is a monster, folks. It's a monster and it needs to have its head crushed. And if we'll strap on our armor every day, if we'll pick up the armor and put it on, if we'll pick up the sword of the Spirit, the sword of the Word, if we'll pick that sword up every day, if we'll get into Scripture and get Scripture into us every day, and if we do the things God's asking us to do every day, we'll chop the head off that snake. We'll eliminate that monster. All we have to do is have faith in what God's calling us to do and step forward and do what he's asking us to do. Matthew 14, verse 23 through 29 says, after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountaintop by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said. And they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Lord, if it is you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. We have to have faith. Peter didn't walk on the water because of Peter. Peter walked on water because of faith. He knew who his Lord and Savior was. He knew who Jesus was. And he walked on water in faith because Jesus said, come. So let's do two action steps on this. I'm going to share two action steps on this with you so that we can fulfill this bucket list without regrets. Right? We don't want any regrets in our life. It's an ugly tattoo. So we want to take some action steps. First action step is step up. Step up. When God calls you to take a step, step up. Just do it. Just do it. Amelia Earhart said, the most difficult thing is the decision to act. The rest is merely tenacity. Our fears are nothing more than paper tigers. You can do anything you decide to do. Now, I'd amend that just a touch. You can do anything when you step out in faith for what God's called you to do. You can do anything. Our fears are paper tigers, she said. In other words, there's nothing to them. They're superficial. You can tear them up. There's no reason to hold those fears. They're there. They look vicious. doesn't mean they are. It's just that decision that we decide we no longer want to be held by the bondage of the chains of these bucket list busters, whether it's fear, whether it's whatever it is, whether it's family whispering something in your ear or friends over here whispering something in your ear, whatever it is, it's step up and do what it is that God's called us to do. We've got one shot at life, and we need to make that shot count, folks. That's just the reality of it. We get one shot. We don't get it. There's not a do-over. This ain't a video game. We don't get a respawn. You know, there we are. We're back. You know, we get to fight the zombies again, you know. It's not that. We get one shot at it, so we need to make it our best shot. And we need to step up when we're called to. And the second action point is step out. Step out. Let's step out and let's face our fears. Let's replace our fears with faith in our Lord, with obedience to our Lord, with what God's called us to have versus fear. Step out with courage. Step out with boldness. Step out with tenacity. And remember, if you want to walk on water and Jesus is calling you, you can walk on water. There's that old saying that says it's better to be on the water with Jesus than in the boat without him. And I'm telling you, that's absolute God's honest truth right there. Get on the water with Jesus. Get on the water with Jesus. And remember this, fear can either stand for face everything and rise, or forget everything and run. It's your choice what you want to do with your fear. You can face everything and rise to the level that God wants you to rise to, or you can fear everything and run. Run in the other direction. Run away from the life that's been promised to you, but you've been afraid to take the steps to live that life. And you can rest assured, anytime you step up, God will step out. And anytime you step out, God will step up. He's going to be right there alongside of you. He's going to walk right with you. He's going to be there. He's going to have his arm around your shoulder. He's going to be encouraging you. You just have to do it. If I had to play it safe, and I could have, I certainly, that day at Celebrate up in Sioux Falls, I could certainly have played it safe. I could have stayed sitting in my chair. When God called me out of that chair, I could have certainly just sat there and said, you know what, I have this precast concrete plant that I've been at for 18, almost 19 years by the time I left. So at that time, 16, almost 17 years. I could just stay there because, you know what, I'm putting a lot of money away towards retirement. I'm doing a lot of things here that, you know, this is pretty safe and secure. I'm the safety coordinator, and at that time I was actually also the quality control guy. So between those two jobs, I could stay here. I got all this time in this company loves its people and really takes care of its people, and they won't fire me unless I pretty much kill someone on the job. Other than that, they'll never fire me. They give everyone every chance you could possibly have. And it's not that I mess up that much, but if I did mess up, then at least I know I'm not going to get fired over it. They're going to come alongside of me just like Jesus would and say, okay, now how do we make this better? How do we fix this? How do we walk through this? So I could have stayed at that precast plant and done that. I could have stayed. I had 4 weeks vacation every year. That's not 4 weeks over 18 years or 16 years. That's 4 weeks every year. I could have planned some pretty good vacations. My wife and I could have been working on retirement and just saying, you know what, I'm just worried about what I'm going to do when I go fishing in the Gulf of Mexico. I'm going to go fishing off the coast of Florida, on the other side of the Gulf of Mexico. You right? I'm going to go do this when we retire. My wife and I, when we retire, if I ever retire, whatever that happens to be, we're going to learn how to golf. Okay, that's just one of them things. It's not like it's really a priority. It's just one of the things that's like, that'd be fun to do together. So someday we'll learn to golf. Not on my bucket list because it's really not that big a deal, right? But it could have been. I certainly could have said, whoa, I can learn how to golf real soon, you know, because we're putting this money away and we're doing our thing. We're doing what we're supposed to do that way. I could have stayed all kinds of safe and secured. God's blessed me with two beautiful daughters who, through their marriages, has blessed me with two beautiful sons, and through that has blessed me with six beautiful grandchildren. I have my beautiful bride. I have a beautiful life. And I could have stayed at that concrete plant and said, you know what? All I got to do is wait till I'm old enough to retire. Just Social Security kicks in. This is easy peasy, man. But God was calling me to do something else. And I had to step out in faith. And I had to trust him. I can tell you I'd be living with a whole lot of regrets right now if I hadn't. I don't say that so that you'd be like, oh, he could have had all that, but no, and now he's where he's at now, right? Because I love where I'm at. I'd rather be here than there any day. Any day. I don't care. It's not that I don't care about ever retiring. It's that I don't care if I retire at 65. I don't know that I'll ever retire. Not fully. I've fallen in love with the Lord and what he's called me to do. This is amazing stuff. As heartbreaking as it is some days, it is so overflowing and overwhelming most days. And even those days when it's kind of heartbreaking because whatever happens, I know he's still got my back. He's still there. That's when Jesus goes, come on, buddy. Let's go. You have to step out in faith each and every day. You have to step out in faith each and every day. And the reason I share that with you is this. I want you to step out in faith. He's calling you to stuff. He's calling each and every person here to something. And I want you to step out in faith. I want you to not have regrets. I want you to not have any regrets. Please watch this.
Edward Perryman Cole died in May. It was a Sunday afternoon, and there wasn't a cloud in the sky. It's difficult to understand the sum of a person's life. Some people will tell you it's measured by the ones left behind. Some believe it can be measured in faith. Some say by love. Other folks say life has no meaning at all. Me, I believe that you measure yourself by the people who measured themselves by you. What I can tell you for sure is that by any measure, Edward Cole lived more in his last days on earth than most people managed to wring out of a lifetime. I know that when he died, his eyes were closed and his heart was open.
Funeral plans tend to confuse me. Specifically, buried or cremated. Take buried. Now I know it shouldn't matter, but I'm claustrophobic. What if I wake up underground and nobody can hear me? They still make those coffins with the bells?
I don't believe they do.
Then cremated. What do you do with the ashes? Do you bury them, scatter them, put them on a shelf, float them down the Ganges on a bed of flowers? What if I feel the flames?
Well, I definitely want to have myself cremated.
Maybe we should go frozen like Walt Disney.
Cremated. Ashes put in a can, buried someplace with a view.
A can, huh?
Yeah. I never liked the sound of the word urn.
Really? Got any special feelings about crypt?
No. No, an old chock full of nuts can will do me just fine.
I'm deeply proud that this man found it worth his while to know me. In the end, I think it's safe to say that we brought some joy to one another's lives. So, one day when I go to some final resting place, if I happen to wake up next to a certain wall with a gate, I hope that Carter's there to vouch for me. and show me the ropes on the other side.
Edward Perryman Cole died in May. It was a Sunday in the afternoon, and there wasn't a cloud in the sky. He was 81 years old. Even now, I can't claim to understand the measure of a life. But I can tell you this. I know that when he died, his eyes were closed and his heart was open. And I'm pretty sure he was happy with his final resting place, because he was buried on the mountain. And that was against the law.
As we wrap up this series is about ending up in a can of chock full of nuts, right? It's about living the life as God intended us to live it, living it with full hearts, about giving away the weight of the world and instead living the life that God has intended for us to live, the life that he called us to live. It's about us not living with regrets, rather living knowing that our eyes are closed, or dying knowing that our eyes are closed and our hearts full. It's about dying as they died. The thing is, see, as we've said all along, we don't know how long we have. I might not finish my next sentence, and I'm okay with that, because I have no regrets about where I'm at. Are there things I wish were in a different situation than they are? Sure. But I can only do what I can do, right? And that's all you can do. Oftentimes I think we worry about, what is it? What if I do this? Well, will that affect that? You have to do what God's calling you to do. And we need to live our life according to the bucket list. We need to live our life according to what God has called us to do. We need to live our life to the full according to his plan. Knowing that when we die and when we get buried, in whatever version of that you have, when we go to that final resting place and when we meet Edwin and at the pearly gates, that we know we took every step that we were supposed to take. We need to know, I can't live this life not knowing that I did exactly what God was asking me to do according to the best of my understanding. See, God is not going to hold it against you if you take a step that you fully believed was a step he was asking you to take and it was in the wrong direction. As long as your heart was pure within it, God's not going to condemn you for that. Because I believe that God would rather we take a step absolutely fully believing that is where he wanted us to go and it be in the wrong direction, then we not be willing to take a step at all. Then we not be willing to step out, fulfill that bucket list, do the things God's called us to do, take the steps on the path he put before us. I would much rather fall flat on my face, and I believe God would much rather each and every one of us fall flat on our face because we thought we were taking a step we were supposed to and it was a tripwire, rather than us not taking a step at all and doing what he's asked us to do. So as we wrap up this series, do a heart check, do a life check, do a priority check, do a faith check. Am I doing what God asked me to do? And if not, start. Start doing what he asked you to do. I'm just so grateful to be on this journey with all of you. And I want us to step out and fulfill that bucket list. The two of them filled out that bucket list. They didn't do it on their own. That's why when people tell me, I stay at home and I watch Harold Salem on church on the TV every week. That's my church. I stay home and I watch the videos when they're online. I don't come to church because I don't need to go to the church. Yeah, but if you don't come to the church, you don't have anyone to walk with. Let us walk together. Let us fill out our bucket list and cross off our bucket list as a family. Please join me as we go to our Father. Dear Lord, thank you so much. I thank you so much, dear Lord, for this series, for the hearts that are changed through this series, dear Lord, for the attitudes that are changed, for the actions that are taken, dear Lord, because you touch someone in this series and they realize, oh, hold on, that's God calling me. They realize they want to end up on the mountaintop, being buried there, even if it is illegal, they don't care, and maybe it gives them a little extra pleasure. Lord, there's people who have said throughout their life, I don't deserve to go to heaven. I don't deserve to be loved by God. I don't deserve this, that, and the other thing. And Lord, when we do what you ask us to do, we deserve it. Lord, when we do, you give us more than we ever, ever, ever deserve. And that's on the day we're born. Dear Lord, we ask that you would lead us, you would guide us, and you would help us to see the steps in front of us, and you would give us the courage to take those steps. Lord, we ask that you would just help us to check off the things you have on our bucket list. We don't know how long we have. We could be here for another 50, 60 years, 80 years for some. We could be here another 50, 60 seconds, 80 for some. Father, it doesn't matter. Help us to live our lives with urgency, with immediacy, and with faith. With faith, Father, that we would do all that you ask us to do. And we just pray these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Next week, we're going to kick off a new series. It's called Shadow of the Cross. It's going to take us up through Easter. It's going to take us through Easter. On Easter, we will have one more move. And I just want to touch a little bit on the Living Last Supper. There's actually two things I want to touch on. Living Last Supper. If you've seen it in Sioux Falls, you've seen one version. If you've seen it here, you've seen another version. And if you've gone on YouTube, you've seen probably 100 other versions. The Living Last Supper is a very powerful, very impactful. I love what Canton United Methodist started this out. They institute, they bring you into that scene in a way that I've never seen before. And it was such a blessing to be a part of that last year. Going to be a part of it again this year. I think, as long as Laura won't kick me out, right? So we're okay. She might make me go behind the scenes. I don't know. We'll be fine. We're going to be a part of that again, and I want to extend you. I want you to understand that this is not about, it's not about being on the stage. It's not about being behind the stage. It's not even about being in the audience. It's about what God will do through that night, through each and every person, no matter where they're at. Okay, so just set your night aside. We're not doing church here. We're doing church together. And it will be the Living Last Supper. So if you, I'm going to send that email. If I have your email, if I don't, get it to me and I'll send it to you. But I'm going to send the email out to everyone I've got emails for and invite you to be a part of that. And I just want you to pray over that and think about that. Now, we're not going to wait a long time. Right? We need to get this set up so we can actually have some time to get things going with it. But if you would like to be a part of that, we'd love to have you.